Right, so A Little Boy Lost in Songs of Experience. Note the title, A Little Boy Lost. By using a little boy, we have an emotive, using a child as an emotive device here. We understand the idea that children equal innocence. Well, how do they equal innocence? Well, they kind of. I think what Blake is picking up on, or what Blake is focusing on, is that idea that children tend to focus that lack of self-consciousness that the rest of us have. Children will ask questions that we are fearful, we wouldn't ask, we wouldn't dream to ask. And it's because children don't have those boundaries placed upon them at that early stage in their life. How many times have you heard a little child swear because they've copied a parent or a brother or a cousin, and they haven't understood the boundaries? Or I can remember in horror, one of my children pointing to somebody and saying, "Why is that person so fat?" And it's awkward as an adult. That's not the sort of question that one would be asking as an adult. But children don't have that kind of moral compass yet, that sense of boundary. And it's because they're innocent. It's because they don't understand. And what we as adults have to do is we have to educate them, and we have to guide them through that kind of moral maze, and teach them to be responsible people. You do that. That's a kind of an ongoing process. This little boy is really struggling with a couple of ideas at the start of this poem. So I think before we jump into the poem, we need to understand some biblical ideas, because the beginning of this poem focuses on some of the words that Christ presented in the Bible according to the Gospel of St. Matthew. And one of the things that Jesus said was, the greatest commandment is love your Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And that's the first and greatest commandment. And the second is love your neighbor as yourself, and that all the law and all the prophets hang upon these two commandments. Now, this boy starts off by saying, "Well, nought loves itself another as itself, nor venerates it so." And the child's confused by the words of the scriptures here. If the scriptures tell us that you should love God with all your heart, and you should also love your neighbor as yourself, then really what that's telling us to do is to love everyone equally. And the child doesn't understand why he's being told that he must love God more than anyone else, because the scriptures actually tell us that love is equal. So he's struggling to comprehend that idea, and he's questioning it. Furthermore, nor is it possible to thought a greater than itself to know. God is presented in the scriptures as greater than the human mind, and the boy is questioning. He's saying, "How can the human mind then, if God is greater than the human mind, how can the human mind comprehend God? Because God is greater than us, so how can we possibly comprehend that?" And the boy is questioning it. Rather than blindly accepting this premise, he's questioning. He's struggling with the idea that the scripture is putting forward. Furthermore, if we're all to love each other equally, he's saying, "How can I love somebody more than another? I love all things equally, so everything within nature equally also." And there is that real lack of understanding, so that the scripture says, "Love your neighbor as yourself," and the boy's questioning, "Well, I love my neighbor, but I love all animals as well. How can there be this multi-stranded concept called love? If love is equality, then everything should be loved equally. But you're telling me that I should be loving things at a different level." And this is a question that the boy is putting forward to the priest. And in a sense, I think, you know, the boy is talking from a viewpoint of innocence, but what the boy is actually doing is picking holes in the scriptures. Okay, the fact that the scriptures tell us these ideas and that the boy is questioning them. Now, in this next stanza, what we understand is the reaction of the priest. And the priest sat by and heard the child. In trembling zeal, he seized his hair and led him by his little coat, and all admired his priestly care. And there is this really interesting use of language within this stanza. So what we have is the priest in trembling zeal, and zeal in terms of that blindly following a religious idea, it has kind of like connotations of fanaticism. This is somebody who strongly believes what he says, follows the words of the scriptures without question. Here we have the boy who's questioning those scriptures. And what the priest does is he seizes this child's hair and leads him by his coat. So there are words, you know, words to do with violence here. Priests are held in high regard, yet this priest, in his zeal, grabs the child, and as he's leading him away, the phrase "all admired his priestly care." And that really contradicts the violence, the fact that people accept that the priest here uses violence. They hold him in regard, and really it shows the kind of the blind acceptance of the priest's rule. The fact that they allow the priest to do that, and admire because what the priest is do and admire the priest because what the priest is doing is going to punish the child for acting against the words of the scriptures, whereas in reality what the child is doing is questioning what he sees to be a contradiction. So for everybody else, there is this blind acceptance of the priest's rule. They accept what he does without unquestioning faith, in a sense. And the priest, standing on the altar high, says, "Lo, what fiend is here?" said he, "one who sets him up for judge of our most holy mystery." And that idea of this holy mystery is the fact that the priest recognizes that the scriptures themselves are contradictory, yet he's willing to kind of just blindly accept this. Okay, what the boy is doing is he's using reason to question faith, and to question the scriptures. And in doing so, in saying, "Do you know what? There's a problem here. I am questioning it. I want to know what the answers are." Instead of being educated, instead of being given that kind of moral guidance, as I spoke at the end, in terms of saying, "Well, this is how it works," the priest has no answers. He just calls it a holy mystery. So the priest himself is kind of like beheld to these contradictory scriptures. And what he does is he accuses this child of being a demon, and accuses of him of heresy. And I think really what Blake is doing here is he's being critical of a system that requires devotees to kind of blindly accept what they are told, and that would be the priest and those people who follow the priest himself. In a sense, the fact that they all admire this holy mystery, it shows, because they're unquestioning, in a sense what people are doing is they're trapping themselves. It equates back to the idea of mind forged manacles. People allow themselves, by not questioning, they allow themselves to be entrapped in the systems of control. So the manacles, the things that trap them, they're mind forged, they're things that they allow to happen. Now, what we have is the weeping child could not be heard. The weeping parents wept in vain. They stripped him of his little shirt and bound him in an iron train. So we have The idea that the little boy being bound in chains is symbolic of this oppression. You know, if you question the powers that be, if you question the priest, then he is in here. It's kind of a literal punishment. And the boy is metaphorically silenced by the martyrdom. Okay, so a punishment for heresy was burning at the stake. Actually, it wasn't burning at the stake, wasn't widely used within this country, but it was a punishment for heresy, a punishment for speaking out against the Catholic Church. Notice the very emotive language. We have the weeping child, and the fact that when he stripped to his little shirt. But also, we have this idea of the weeping parents. The fact that what we have are the real controllers of this child morals guidance. It should be down to the parent to punish the child, yet the parent's power is being taken away from them by the priest, hence the weeping. Now, this final stanza is really quite interesting, because we have the parents weeping in vain, the fact that they are unable to do anything, yet we have this really interesting final rhetorical question here. Now, Albion is just a very old English term for England, and the fact that Blake uses this ancient name shows perhaps that this is an ongoing process, that there has been a lack of evolution here, that this was happening hundreds of years ago and is still happening today. So it shows this the fact that this system of control has not evolved, it is continuing through. And what he's saying is, are such things done on Albion Shore? And he's saying, I can't believe this is still happening in this country. I can't believe this is happening today. And what he's questioning really is this idea that free thought is destroyed, that people are not allowed a voice. People are not allowed to question, but that system of control. And in a sense, it's being very critical of organized religion, and on how organized religion forces you to be a blind devotee, as opposed to being the sort of devotee that you want to be, as Blake himself was. Blake had his own beliefs in God, and he was a very, very religious person. He struggled to understand why people would follow a restrictive religion that stopped, or how what he believed stopped people from believing in equality, and stopped people from loving freely. So how is this boy lost? Going back to the start, this boy is, in a sense, it seems that this boy is lost to religion. But that would be Blake saying, is he really lost? He is lost to this religion of control only. So with this poem, think about that idea about free thought, how free thought is destroyed, and how people are controlled. But not only how people are controlled, but how they allow themselves to be controlled. Most of the time, when you're talking about that idea of people allowing themselves to be controlled, it all comes back down to that mind forge manacles, that people accept that control is placed upon them, and refuse to question it, or do not question it, and therefore become entrapped within that system.